So I see how y'all doing this day, because you know this is the day that the Lord has made. I am Prophetess Charlene Denise Holt, and we just want to welcome you tonight in the comfort of our private home and our home. Our home is your home. So tonight we just want to give God praise and give God glory. You know why? Because he is worthy of all the praise and all the glory. He is our Lord, he is our King, and he is his Son, Jesus Christ, is the Savior of the world. And I'm just glad to be here tonight. How about you? And we just want to welcome you tonight to our Tuesday night Bible study. We want to walk you to walk with us through the Word of God tonight. God is always up to something. God is always saying something. All we have to do is just incline our ear to hear what he is saying. And get ready to hear what God is saying tonight. We love you. God bless each and every one of you is our prayer. So tonight, we're just going to lift him up and magnify him and glorify his name. God is good, and he is worthy, worthy to be praised. Our bishop is going to be joining us momentarily and going to come on in tonight. I'm going to pray. I'm going to get out the way so God can get in the way and have his way. So tonight, God, we just come tonight to praise you, to magnify your name, for your name is great and great to be praised. God, we pray, dear God, for your people tonight, God, that they will in tune their ear, incline their ear to hear what you are saying tonight, God. And God, let your let their ears fall in on this good ground and hear what the Spirit of the Lord is just saying to the church tonight, God. God, we lift you up and we bless your holy name. God, we ask you to bless each and every one that are tuned in tonight and watching or may watch later, dear God. We ask that you will bless them and enlarge their territory. This we ask in no other name but your precious, your only begotten Son, Jesus' name we pray, and we give you all the praise and all the glory. Amen, amen, and amen. It is so good to be here tonight. Oh, my God. Lord, we just thank you, thank you. Just let's just magnify him for a moment. Amen. Hallelujah. I will lift up my eyes to the hills from which cometh my help. All my help come from the Lord. In spite of all that's going on in this world, God is still in control. Hallelujah. And if he is in control, God got this. There's nothing too hard for him. God got this. He got the whole world in his hand. He got me, you, little bitty baby in his hands. Hallelujah. He's glorious. He's marvelous. And he is worthy, worthy to be praised. Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah. Wonderful. Marvelous. Hallelujah.
Hello there.
Hi.
Hey, Mom, what's up?
Hi.
All right. Yeah. Ready to get started here?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Marvelous. Devil Coley. He's marvelous. He's wonderful. Well, welcome tonight to our Tuesday night live Bible study.
Amen.
Amen. Walking in the Word. We are so grateful and so elated that you have joined us tonight.
Yeah.
As we get ready to study the Word of God.
Yeah.
God is good all the time.
All the time.
And all the time God is good.
He's good.
And he is worthy to be praised.
Amen.
We are so blessed to be here tonight, and you are so blessed to be here as well.
Yes.
And we thank you for being so committed and so being good stewards.
Amen.
As we study the Word together and ask God to give us fresh rhema. Give us fresh revelations.
Amen.
As he unravel his word in our minds, body, and soul tonight.
Yes.
And as always, I am truly blessed to have my life partner here, Pastor Charlene. And we're going to do as the Lord will direct tonight as he speaks through our hearts and speak to you. So let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you, God, for this wonderful opportunity. And for this awesome privilege to be here in your presence. As always, we pray tonight that you will give us an ear to hear, a heart to receive, and a mind to do what your word will instruct us tonight. Again, give us fresh rhema and a revelation of your word, that we may walk worthy before you, that we may do those things you have assigned our hands to do. This we ask in Jesus' name. And the church said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Wow, we had such a powerful weekend. We had to take care of some pressing business. We laid to rest my dad in the ministry, Pastor Edward Grace, for 46 years in the pastorate there at New Mount Zion. And our good friend Orlando, Pastor Prophet Sheila J. Spencer of the Times of Refreshing, was laid to rest also on Saturday. So we are grateful and thankful to God for the generals, for the gifts that he had placed in our lives to guide us, to lead us, and to give us direction. And we thank God for the lasting memories and the wonderful wisdom and nuggets that they departed into our lives.
Amen.
Amen. We won't be the same. I don't think we'll never be the same.
Never.
But we must do as the Lord has also said to us, to press on, keep on keeping on. And we got to run on now.
Amen.
And see what the end is going to be. Prophets, on last week, we had a great discussion about prayer. And we talked about different aspects of prayer, different facets of prayer. And that's one of your favorite subjects. And we talked about how we must continue to pray in spite of.
Amen.
And continue to press in spite of. And I know the Lord has spoke to you concerning that and always speak to you concerning prayer. So I just want you to get some time tonight to give us some nuggets again, you know, from your heart as to what the Lord is saying to you concerning the area of prayer.
No, the Bible just says man ought to always pray so we won't faint. Because so many of us faint because we're not praying in the face of God. So man ought to always be in a position to pray. And then just to pray without ceasing. It's prayer is the key, is the vehicle to God's heart. So just pray when you're going through your trials and whatever your tribulation, and just when you're not going through anything, just pray. Because he says for us to seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness, all these things will be added unto us. So I'm always seeking him in prayer. And you can always seek him in the word of God, the word. Pray. All you have to do is pray what the word of God say. His word. Lord, the Lord, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. We want his will to be done in us. So we pray. The Lord's prayer, or just pray in your own heart what God has laid upon your heart, because the sincere prayers of the righteous availeth much.
Right.
And when you pray much, I always say much prayer,
much power,
a little prayer,
little power.
And if you don't have no prayer life, you have no
power.
And prayer is a firm foundation. It's a solid rock.
Yeah, prayer is what we do. And prayer is what we must do in order to stay in the face of God so that we can find relief and get what we need. I mean, Hebrews 4:16, we always use this in our corporate prayer. He says, let us go boldly before the throne of grace that we may find help in the time of our need. And no doubt all of us have a need or some needs that we need to lay before God in prayer.
And also says the prayers of the righteous
availeth much. Availeth much, got much power, and yield much results.
Amen.
So we are grateful and thankful for the opportunity to pray. You know, sometimes people have an opportunity, but don't take advantage of that opportunity. They have a chance to pray, but they don't pray.
And let your prayers be sincere.
Yes, got to be from your
sincerity.
Heart, right? From
yes.
your heart, from your heart. Now tonight, we're going to get into another subject tonight. And prayer is always wrapped around this. Faith is always wrapped around our discussions. And tonight, we're going to talk about the love of God. Just the love of God. The immeasurable love of God. And, you know, the Bible says that God's love surpasseth all understanding. And we're going to give you some scriptures tonight as we look at this word. This is a powerful word tonight, powerful subject, as we begin to explore. We won't cover it all. You can't cover it all. But we want to just talk about the love of God, how much God loves mm-hmm. us in so many ways, and his the magnitude of God's love.
Love is so wide.
So wide.
The Bible said God so loved the world that he gave his only son.
Wow.
And one thing love is, the love of God is greater than tongues or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and it reaches the lowest hell. Love.
Wow. The highest star and the lowest hell.
Mm-hmm.
That's covering a whole lot of ground.
Yeah.
So that means wherever you are and whoever you are in the vicinity where God's love can reach you.
Yes.
You are not out of reach. You are in reach
yes.
of the love of God. Now, our foundational scriptures tonight, we want to give you two. One is found in the book of Philippians, chapter number 4. And you can't talk about God's love without talking about God's peace. So Philippians chapter 4 and verses 6 and 7. I believe you had it in the NIV. Would you read it, Charlene?
In verse 4, it says, always be full of joy. Is that?
No,
that.
Oh, right. Yes.
Don't worry. Okay, I'm sorry. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your heart and mind as you live in Christ Jesus.
My God, my God. In the NET, the New English Translation, it reads like this. Do not be anxious about anything. Instead, in every situation, through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, tell your request to God. That's the prayer part. Tell your request to God. Whatever it is, whatever you got to talk to God about, talk to God about it. Whatever you got to talk to God about, talk to God about it. All right? Stop talking to everybody else. Talk to God about it. And the Bible says when we do this, verse number 7, he says, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, that blows your mind, that cannot be comprehended. It says, he will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
Mm.
The peace of God, after you have prayed, after you have laid it on the table with God, after you have
yes.
poured out your heart to God in prayer, whatever you need to talk to God about, talk to God about it. And once you have placed it on the altar, once you have given it over to God, there's a peace.
Amen.
There's a peace that will come over you. Watch me now. There's a peace that will come over you, that will calm you, that will settle you. And he says, this peace will surpass all understanding.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that powerful?
That's very powerful.
I mean, it goes beyond.
Yes.
It goes beyond all understanding.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you won't be able to comprehend how much peace God is giving you in your situation.
Amen. And he tells us, he says, Paul is saying, imagine, never worry about anything. It seems like it's impossible. Sometimes things seem like they're impossible. We all have worried about our job, our home, our school. But Paul said, advised us to turn this over, our worries, into prayer.
Yeah, I love it. Turn your worries over into prayers, into petitions.
Mm-hmm.
Turn your worries over mm-hmm. into prayers, into making your petitions known unto God. So whatever you got to talk to God about, talk to God about it.
Because if you want to worry less, then you need
pray
to
more.
Pray more.
Yeah. Worry less by praying more. I like that.
Mm-hmm.
Worry less by praying more in sincerity. Be genuine in your prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Make your request known unto
Amen.
Him. Don't
Amen.
Worry about anything. Don't be anxious about anything. Mm-hmm. Instead, pray about
everything. So then when you turn it over to prayer, then you worry less.
Yeah.
Turn your worries into prayer.
That's when you start experiencing the peace of God in your life. You see, Some of us tonight need to be calm. We need a calming now. You know, things happen in life. Things are happening in life. Things happens in life, and things are happening in life that cause us sometimes to worry, mm-hmm. or to be overly concerned, you know, or to become burdened.
Amen.
And therefore, we need an outlet. Mm-hmm. And that outlet is prayer.
Fervent prayer.
Yes, yes.
Fervent prayer.
Yeah. You know, fervent prayer, because we're asking God in prayer by faith.
Yes. It soothes your soul, it soothes your spirit.
Oh, wow. So that soothing of your soul and of your spirit is needed and is needful, and that's what God is releasing. Mm-hmm. He is releasing a peace over you.
That
surpasses all understanding. People say, well, I don't understand how you can be at peace, how you can be so calm in this situation, while others are, you know, losing it, others are throwing in the towel, others are pulling out their hair, you know, they're pacing the floor late at night. They just don't know what they're going to do, you know. Well, I know what to do. Pray.
Mm-hmm. You remember when Peter was out there and the storm was right? Jesus was out there in the midst of the storm and the sea, and he was so at peace.
Yeah.
But Peter got what?
He was perturbed.
Right.
But the Lord was at peace. He was asleep. Mm-hmm. But then he got up in the midst of that storm, that raging storm, the rage in the disciples. He walked right past them, stood on the bow of that ship, and spoke to the wind and said, peace be still. Mm, and the waves behaved.
And that's true peace.
That's peace. Mm-hmm. Now, only God can give you peace. Listen, only God can give you that kind of peace that surpasses all understanding. We're going to work on this tonight. That surpasses all understanding. Jesus said, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world give it, give I unto you. That's in the Gospel of John.
Yes, yes.
So this kind of peace only comes from God.
Yes.
He can calm your situation. He can calm you in the midst of your trouble, in the midst of your pain.
My God.
He can give you peace. Now, there's another scripture that I want to give to you that's going to be also telling and revelation as we talk about this particular peace that God gives us, that's found in Ephesians, in the book of Ephesians, chapter number 3. Watch this. In Ephesians, chapter number 3, and we're going to start looking at some powerful verses. We're going to start right at verse number 17. This is what he says in the NET. Okay? He says in the New English Translation.
Okay.
Ephesians, chapter 3, write this one down, saints. Verses 17 is where we're going to start in at. He says, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. It's number one. So that because you have been rooted and grounded in love. So Christ is dwelling in our hearts through faith. We believe in God by faith. You know, we believe God. By grace are we saved through faith. We believe in God. We made a confession of faith. And therefore we know Christ is dwelling in our hearts. And now because he is in our hearts, we are now rooted and grounded in love, not in hate and not in fear. God didn't give us the spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind.
Amen.
All right. Verse number 18, he says, you may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth. And thus, to know the love of Christ, to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge.
My God. Okay.
Now, in Philippians, it was peace that surpasses understanding. But in Ephesians, it is the love of God, the love of Christ, that surpasses knowledge.
The love of Christ.
So that you will be made filled up to all the fullness of God. So that you may be filled up to the fullness of God. When you are rooted and grounded in his love, when you are rooted and grounded in the love of God, when the love of God mm. have have you, your front, your back, and all in between. When you are rooted and grounded, that means you're not moved by every wind and doctrine, by every trial and tribulation. Mm. You're not bothered by every trouble that comes your way because you know the love of God. The love of God.
Yeah.
And therefore, he says, his love is so wide. His love is so tall. Mm. His love is so deep. His love is so wide that we cannot comprehend it. Okay. He says, and thus know the love of Christ that surpasseth knowledge. My God, we will never understand how massive the love of God is. You said it in your opening statement. You said it right there. Mm-hmm. You know, to the highest stars and to the deepest.
It's greater than anything. God love is greater than anything. Any pen we could ever tell, it goes beyond the highest star that reaches the lowest hell. Love is just, it's high and it goes low. It goes wide. It's everywhere. God is love.
He's love. I mean, God, his love is so massive, and it extends to the widest of the wide, and to the mm-hmm. highest of the high, to the lowest of the low. You see, it is incomprehensible. You know, when we start thinking about how much love God has for us, you know, it goes beyond our faults. Mm-hmm. It goes beyond our flaws. It goes beyond our failures. And all of us have faults, all of us have flaws, mm-hmm. and every one of us have experienced failure. So therefore, even though we may have faults, flaws, and failures, God's love, catch us where we are. Mm.
The love.
Thank God.
When I think about, love, his love looked beyond my faults and saw my needs. Love can conquer, love can put out any fire.
Any fight.
Love any can fight. Heal any situation if we allow and let God love us and love in that situation. It can soothe it. But sometimes what we do as human, we get in it and we want to, you know, give them a piece of what we got and that we got too much of a mind. So let that love just flows and goes through us from person to person. Yeah. This will be a better world.
The NIV says this in verse number 19. He says, and to know this love, and to know this love, God's love, and to know this love, mm-hmm. and to know this love, that surpasseth knowledge. You see, we have just a fragment. Mm-hmm. We have just a small understanding of the massive amount of love that God has for us. So when we just know the love that surpasses, we know the love that surpasses, that is so wide, that is so high, that is so deep, that is so, you know, breathtaking.
Yes.
This love surpasses all knowledge. You know, we will blow a fuse trying to understand the love of God.
The love of God is so great. What happened in a lot of us, I think the love of God, like, it's wax cold.
Yes.
And when we get wax cold, you can't, oh my God. Yeah. Can't touch nobody. Can't touch you.
See, we may experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to understand. Though we can experience it, though it is too great to understand, but we understand that it is transformative. Mm. The love of God is transformative. It transforms individuals. It transforms sinners into saints. It transforms losers into winners.
So it changes us.
It changes us. Mm-hmm. So when we experience his love like that, I mean, nothing else can do this for us.
Money
can't, people can't, job can't, you know. I mean, this is the love of God.
When you love someone, or even a child, when they know they're loved, the eyes get all bright, they begin to smile. You just feel so good when you knowing somebody loving you and loving on you, and instead of, you know, putting you down with negative words, but when they love you, you feel like you can do anything. And that's a beautiful thing if you're married, and when a wife know that her husband love her, beyond any other thing in this world. He loves her. And the same thing with that wife, love, and you can trust one another. That is a beautiful thing. That is, oh my God, it's like everything. You can do anything.
It's awesome. And another commentary says about this understanding of this love. He says this, I love what he says. He says, from this translation, we understand that we can only understand or experience in a measure. We can only understand or experience in a measure of the love of Christ. We cannot understand it fully or completely. It is very wide, very long, very deep, very high. It surpasses all understanding.
Knowledge.
So I just want you to know, knowledge and understanding, you know, it just goes beyond what our mind can comprehend, mm-hmm. or what we can fully, we don't understand a measure of it, not the full measure. Because the full measure, we will never know. It's too much for us. All right? So this love is great. Now, how great is the love? How great is God's love? It's great because according to John 3:16, it says what? For God what?
So loved
the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So we see even here the width and the height and the depth of God's love. God loved the world. You know, God loved those who were in the world. He so loved the world that he decided in himself to give his only begotten son. And Jesus so loved us that he decided to give his life on Calvary as a sacrifice, not for man, but for sin. See? Mm-hmm. Because it was the sin that separated man from God. Mm-hmm. So he didn't die just for man. He died in man's place to sacrifice sin, to put sin in his place so that man can have a way back to God.
Yes.
Amen. According to John 15 and 13, this is what it says. Greater love has no one than this, than one would lay down one's own life for his friends.
Amen.
So God, you know, made sure that he laid down his life for his friends. For his friend. He called us friends. Mm-hmm. Even while we were enemies.
Because he loved us. He so loved us that his son Jesus came to stand in the gap. God love is he loved us so deeply. You ever loved somebody so deep? It was a deep love
when they didn't love you back.
Mm-hmm.
They were enemies. I mean, can you love your enemies like that? That's not this. He
loved us so deeply that love covered over the multitude of sin that we had sinned and all of us had fallen short. That love was so great that Jesus was willing. God, you made them. You didn't just make them.
It was amazing. It's amazing. And the question is, can we love like that? Can we love like that, right?
And agape love.
Can we love like that? Can we love beyond what people do? Can we love beyond what people say?
Mm-hmm. Can we love beyond, like, not just the love of words, with tongues, or just with action?
Yeah. Your heart. Well, I mean, even in Jesus says to us, he says, love your enemies. You know, love your enemies and pray for them that despitefully use you. Now listen, you know and I know that's a hard pill to swallow.
That's a hard pill.
When you know you got somebody who is, you know, trying to take you down, dig a hole, dig a trench, you know, put obstacles, traps in your way. And in spite of all of that, you got to do what?
Love.
You got to love them. You got to love them anyhow. And that's what he said. You know, he said, I love you like that.
Mm-hmm. God loves us even in our darkest hours.
I love you like, look what it says in Romans 5, 6 and 8. He put it this way. For when we were still without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly.
Wow.
That was you and me.
Wow.
That was you and me. There was a point in our life when we were not saved, No one have been saved all of their life. Amen. Matter of fact, some have been backslide. So he said, when you was without strength.
I was weak.
When you were weak, had flaws, had failures and faults. He says, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Yet perhaps for a good man, someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrated his own love toward us in that while we were yet still sinners. Know what Christ did? He died for us.
Because God's love is unconditional.
Man, this is mind-blowing love.
His love is very different from human love.
This kind of love surpasses knowledge and understanding. The human mind cannot comprehend
that. It's a different type of love like we have for one another. God love is unexplainable.
It's not just a feeling. And it's not emotional. This is not filial love. Mm-hmm. This is not eros love. This is agape. Mm. This is godly love. You know, it's not just for a pleasure or a feeling.
Yes.
For a minute or for a moment. This goes beyond even before the moment. When we were without strength, when we were yet hanging over hell's door, when the hellhound was still on our track, trying to turn us back, when we were headed to hell wholesale, you see, Christ did something for us. Mm. He demonstrated his love.
He gave his only son.
God,
and I'm just telling you, that's a difference from us.
Oh, my God.
I'm telling you, when people can do us wrong or get on our bad side, man, they stay on. Some of us keep them on our bad side. We never allow them to come back in because whatever they may have, the offense they done to us, we can't forget and we don't want to forgive. But God forgave us all, Bishop.
But God demonstrated his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners.
And that's what he wants us to demonstrate with one another.
Yes. We got to go beyond.
Yes. We got to
go beyond our feelings. You know, go beyond our emotions.
Yes.
And just, you know what? We got to suck this up. Mm-hmm. And we got to demonstrate now. Yeah. We got to demonstrate our love for humanity and for one another.
And if we can get that, and that can be a part of our lifestyle, be a part of our heart. I think countries and can come together, families can come together, marriages can come together, we can come together. But we won't allow that word to resonate and rise up in our
spirit. You got to want it.
You got
to want to receive this love. I mean, this love is available. It's available to anyone who wants it, but you got to want it. What I like about it is that he is not going to force his love on us. He makes it available for us. It's available for us if we want it. Mm. If we want it. All right? Now, Christ didn't die for the righteous. This one blew my mind. Christ didn't die for the righteous. He died for the sinner. Can you imagine that? Mm. You know, so people think, well, I'm saved. I'm so right. No. Well, great. Hallelujah. But when Christ died, he didn't die for the righteous. He died for the sinner, for the outcast, for the left out, for those who didn't have a way back. He put his life on the line in your place. He paid the price that we could never pay. He became the propitiation for our sin. He became the substitute to bring us back to God. You see? And it's very important to understand this love of Christ, even if not fully, because unless we understand it as believers, we cannot be filled to the full with God himself.
Love we can't explain it. We can try to tell it the best that we could, but just love just surpasses all quotes. Love surpasses all understanding. And love just go beyond the deepest river. The heavens, love is just everywhere. When you look around, you can see the attributes of God love.
God is love.
God is love. And God love us in spite of all of our faults. And I don't know about you or nobody else, but I know with me, I got so many And if it had not been for him, he looked beyond all my faults, all my mess, all the things I've done, and all of the things nobody else know but me. He looked beyond all of that and saw my needs. He loved us. He still allowed his only begotten son to come, stand in the gap for us because he loved us so much. He loved us more than we love our own selves.
Yes, yes. Psalms 24:1 says this, "The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein." The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world, and they, that's us, that dwell therein. So John 3:16, when it says, "For God so loved the world,"
yes.
he loved this world. He created it. He made it. He so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. You don't have to perish. You don't have to go under. You can get back with God. You can come back home. It's available. You see? And that's what's so mind-blowing. God, I've done so many wrong things. God, I don't deserve your love. God, how can you love me?
You know, oh my God, how can you love me? I'm just thinking about like loving somebody. And you know, like it's their birthday.
Yeah.
Or it's their special day and you would give them a token because you love them. I'm just thinking about us as you being a leader. And when it comes around to your pastor's appreciation and how much you like, people go, you know, only a certain amount, they'll love you like that.
Well, that's another
something
subject.
Like that. But God so loved, he gave everything he had for us.
Without expecting anything in return. Without expecting anything in return.
All he just wanted us to do he just
wanted to make himself available to a backslider, to a transgressor, to a sinner.
That we might have
Who would one day become sick of his sin, of her sin, and want to come back home. He died for the sin, for the sinner. So that one day, if that sinner would confess with his or her mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in his or her heart that God has raised Jesus from the dead, the Bible says, "Thou shalt be saved."
My God.
We have an opportunity to come home. This mind blowing.
This love is so big. It's
I can't
so wide.
Understand it.
There's no definition, no biblical definition that can really describe the love of God.
No.
There's no love that we can try to tell you and you could try to tell us, but there is nothing. No man can really explain it.
Some have tried to measure it, but they can't. There's no measuring tape big enough, long enough, wide enough, high enough, deep enough. Some have tried to explain it, but it is so unexplainable. It's mind blowing. The only thing we know is that it's available. Now, 1 John 4:8 says this: "He who does not love does not know God."
Wow.
You hear that one? "He who does not love does not know God. For God is love." For God is love.
God is love.
And therefore, if we don't love, then we don't know God. And we don't have the love of God in us. We got to be able to love unconditionally. Love unconditionally.
Yes.
You see, not just the righteous, but the unright. Not just the saved, but the unsaved. Jew and Gentile. Amen. So we've got to understand that it is the love of God that is available to all of us because it surpasses all understanding. Crisscross all boundaries.
Wow.
1 John 4:16 says, "And we have known and believe that the love that God has for us, that God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God." He who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. That's how you know you love God. Because his love abiding you, you abiding him, you got to love. You become a conduit for God's love. You help transfer God's love. And when that love is transferred, it helped transform. Mm. It helped transform sinners into saints, losers into winners. Amen.
Amen.
Unsaved into saved. When you allow that love, his love, to flow freely through you.
So we just got, we got to know the love of Christ. We got to know it. That it surpasses everything.
It's the key word. It's the key word. It's the key word. I mean, we got to love God like we love people.
Yeah,
husband got to love your wife. Wife got to love your husbands. Yeah. You got to love your children.
Yeah, love is the key. It's the attributes of every Christian. It should be.
By this, the Bible says, by this shall all men know that you are my followers, my disciples. If you have what? Love one for another.
And if we love him, we will keep his commandments.
And his word. That's what Jesus said. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my word. Mm-hmm. If you love me, keep my word. Mm-hmm. So you are a keeper of his word. Mm-hmm. So if you don't keep the word of God, we know God's not in you. Mm-hmm. His love is not in you.
Yeah.
And if you don't love everybody, we know the love of God is not in you. Amen? So it's not that we'll have to defy in order to test a lie. You know, it's evident. It's gonna, what's in you gonna come out.
It's like out of the heart, the issues flow, and the love gonna it flows out of you.
Yes.
It flows over to others.
Yes.
It's
so easy, isn't it? It's so easy.
And love is real. It's authentic. It's not fake. It's genuine.
It's gotta be.
It's kind. It's sweet.
Yes. And prayer, again, when you have a difficult moment, trying to love somebody that looks like they're unlovable, that's a good time to pray. Because prayer will take the pressure off you. Mm. Prayer will take the pressure off you and put the peace of God back on you. Hallelujah. When you got to pray for somebody who don't love you, baby, get the pressure off of you, give that to God so that his peace can come back upon you.
I thank God for the love, the beginning of understanding. I think it's love.
Yeah.
You gotta love.
I love the Lord. David said, I love the Lord. He heard my cry and he came to my rescue. Thank God for Jesus.
And the old saints say that love lifted me.
Yeah.
When
nothing else could help.
Love lifted me.
Yes,
somebody need lifting tonight. Just love.
Yes. Yes.
And
yes.
Love is so kind, it don't boast.
Yes.
It's not angry.
Yes.
It's not easily what?
Provoke. We're going to close that with that.
Mm.
You know.
This.
Yeah, I love that. You just hit it on the head. If we go to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, and in the NET, it says it this way. I love it. That's been a good way to close out this discussion. Paul says this. He says, if I speak in tongues of men and of angels, but I do not have love, I am a noisy gong.
Just making a lot of.
Or a clinging cymbal. And if I have prophecy and know all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away everything I own, and if I give over my body to be boast, but do not have love, he says, I receive no benefit. Love is patient. Love is kind. It is not envious.
Wow.
Love does not brag.
Don't puff up.
It is not puffed up. Mm-hmm. It is not rude. It is not self-serving. It is not easily angered or resentful. It is not glad about injustice, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things. That's what love does. It bears all things. Love believes all things. Love hopes all things. And love endures all things. Love never ends. Love never fails. But if there are prophecies, they will be set aside.
Yes.
If there are tongues, they will cease. If there is knowledge, it will be set aside. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when what is perfect comes, the partial will be set aside. Mm-hmm. Paul says, when I was a child, I talked like a child. Mm-hmm. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. But when I became an adult, I set aside childish ways. Mm-hmm. For now we see in a mirror, indirectly. But then we will see face to face. Now I know in part, but then I will know fully, just as I have been fully known.
Amen.
And now these three remains: faith, hope, and love. Amen. But the greatest of these is love. Love that surpasses all knowledge, all understanding. So that the peace of God will guard our heart. That the peace of God will guard our hearts and come upon you in times of uncertainty. Let's love like God loves.
Amen.
All right, prophets, take us in.
And just, when I was a child, I spoke as a child. I act like a child. When I came a man, I put away those things. And we are to love ye one another like Christ loved the church. Just love, love. It's time. What we need now during this pandemic is love. So tonight we just want to thank all of the viewers, you that have tuned in. We thank you, and we just pray for you, and we lift you up, and we want you to, hallelujah. Tomorrow morning we're going to be on Breakthrough Prayer, and it's the same time from 6 to 7, and if you want to tune in with us on Breakthrough Prayer. Amen. Amen. So we'll see you next time. We love you, but know that God loves you best. Amen. See you all.